featuring inside Bobcat athletics here at TXTBobcat.com for National Signing 2018. As you take a look inside War Room at the End Zone Complex here. Welcome to live coverage. We apologize for coming on just a bit late, but what would National Signing Day be without a few technical difficulties? Brant Freeman here with you alongside Bill Culhane. We have live coverage throughout the day to include the reveal of every signee of the 2014 Texas State class. We're talking with the coaches who are responsible for bringing these players to Texas State, including head coach Titus Francione. But first, Bill, welcome to the telecast here, live webcast here of National Signing Day 2014. Always an exciting time across the country, and particularly right here at Texas State.
Exactly right, Brand. The End Zone Complex, of course, is abuzz with activity, with excitement, and I think you would agree it's a lot like Christmas morning, ready to open up presents and see what the future of Texas State Bobcat football has in store for us.
Well, there's a lot that goes into signing a player to commit to play college football at the Division I level. Let's take our viewers through that process, and you know, what does it take to get a player to sign his letter of intent?
It's a lot of hard work, not only, of course, by the student-athlete, their families, their coaches, and a number of other people, but on the Texas State side as well. Not just the coaching staff, but the administration, others on campus. A lot of folks have been involved, have invested in making National Signing Day what it's going to be today for Texas State University. It all starts with the letter of intent. The fax machine over in the football office has been a buzz all morning. When you and I got off the elevator this morning, there were already cheers echoing throughout the halls here at the End Zone Complex. And the LOI essentially means it's the end of the recruiting process, where a student-athlete puts their name on the dotted line, faxes it over to the Texas State football office, and that signifies that the student-athlete accepts the expectations, the requirements, and the benefits of being a student-athlete at Texas State University.
There is a compliance process as well to getting this all done.
There is. It's not just the football coaches who are at the End Zone Complex this morning. Thomas Samuel from the Texas State Athletics Department Compliance Office is here. Kelsey Solis is back at the Darren Casey Building across campus. And what they do is, as the LOIs come in this morning and have been coming in, they check them over, make sure that the LOIs meet all the requirements of the NCAA, of the university, make sure that no T is left uncrossed, no I is left undotted.
All right,
undotted,
so,
right?
Undotted, yeah, I like that. So that's all the yellow tape and the black and white of the process. Let's get to the football itself. The areas of need for Texas State going into the 2014 class, you and I will agree, coming in the trenches, offense and defensive line.
Well, and I think back, and obviously, Brant, you and I have seen a lot of Bobcat football over the course of our 10-plus years together in the broadcast booth. Teams that win are good on the offensive line. They're good on the defensive line. You think back 2 years ago, the Western Athletic Conference champions, Utah State, the Aggies. I remember you and I throughout that broadcast, we commented about their talent, but we really talked about the offensive line, the defensive line, the way they handled the line of scrimmage. This past season, the Bobcats' first year in the Sun Belt Conference, I think you would agree that you looked at the Raging Cajuns, the University of Louisiana, and you look at Arkansas State, two of the premier programs in the Sun Belt Conference, really good up front, offensive line, defensive line. And Coach Fran has been saying since he took over the program during his second tenure here that we have to win the line of scrimmage.
Well, defensive line, considering what the Bobcats have lost, Blake McCullough, DJ Injury, Jordan Norfleet, Jamie Clavell Head, that's important. Devin Baker lost on the offensive line. In the secondary as well, you're losing two starting safeties coming into the 2014 season, Darren Matthews and Justin Wuji, and Xavier Daniels in the secondary, a cornerback as well. So a lot to be replaced, but I tell you what, we're about to bring on recruiting coordinator Ruben Vaughn to talk about the process. In the meantime, Bill, let's go over to the big board. Well, you'll take a look at the mid-year transfers and the first signees of the day.
Yeah, it's the big board. We're getting kind of fancy in the End Zone Complex. And first of all, we talk about numbers all the time, and a lot of times it's statistics that we talk about. Well, in terms of depth numbers, I think we would agree, and you just pointed out, some of the Bobcats were losing on the defensive side of the ball. Really talented football players, experienced football players, lost on the defensive side of the ball. So let's start there. And it's Darnell Daly at linebacker. Of course, you have Mike Arakpo coming back. David Mayo's coming back. Steven Smith, a freshman, got a lot of time at linebacker due to Mayo's injury. And can't forget of course, Jared Jeter Gilman also. But some of the information on Daly, he's a 6'1", 230-pound physical linebacker from San Pablo, California. Last season at Contra Costa, had 68 tackles, 53 solo stops as a sophomore, also had 2.5 quarterback sacks, and is a guy who makes plays behind the line of scrimmage. So there's your linebacker, Brant. And now we'll turn over to the offensive side of the ball. Quarterback, right? You never have too many quarterbacks in a program. Need depth at the position. You've got Tyler Jones, your freshman quarterback, who has a lot of games, a lot of experience under his belt. A couple of quarterbacks here, Randy Price and Connor White. Both quarterbacks have good size. You start with Randy Price. He's 6'3", 205 pounds, comes from Waco, Texas, University High School in Waco. So, of course, Coach Fran with LaDainian Tomlinson, former TCU Horned Frog, who played under Coach Fran at TCU, has some familiarity there. And he's from Tyler Junior College, a very good JUCO program. Connor White, he's a guy who's 6'5", 195 pounds. He's out of Georgia. Played last year at Fork Union Military Academy, a program, of course, that has put out a number of football players in the FBS level. And so he's had a lot of experience, a multi-athlete kind of guy. He played a number of sports in high school in the state of Florida. Tight ends, Ryan Carden comes back. You also have Bradley Miller coming back. Well, Gabe Schrade is a guy who can go downfield and catch the ball as well. He comes from DeLand, Florida. He's 6'4", 225 pounds. Obviously, when he gets in Blake Cundiff's strength and conditioning program, he's going to get bigger, faster, stronger. You look at some of his numbers here. I'll just run through them quickly. Caught 31 balls for 346 yards and 2 scores and rushed for 339 yards. So, obviously, he's a very talented guy who can make plays all over the football field.
And
some of our first signees of the day, Brant, let's first of all start with wide receiver. Andy Erickson, Isaiah Battle, a couple of guys who made some big plays, as you know, in their Bobcat career. P.J. Anderson, a wide receiver, 6'2", 184-pounder, out of Taft High School, not far down the road in San Antonio. And we put him up here under the wide receiver column there for the Bobcats. So there's some more depth. Damon Mercer, a guy who was redshirted a year ago, is ultra-talented. He'll add some depth. Bryce Gunter, a signee from a year ago, can make some incredible plays as well. And then we also have Cameron Knight, another tight end. In the Bobcat offense, the tight end is used a lot, as you know, Brant. And so when you add a guy like Cameron Knight, along with Gabe Schrade, who is already up there in the fold, you're adding some depth there. 6'3", 250-pounder is Cameron Knight out of Shallow Water, Texas. Look at some of his numbers here. Caught 33 balls for 463 yards. He hit the end zone once a year ago for Shallow Water High School, and he's a member of the National Honor Society. And as you visit with Coach Vaughn here in a moment, Brant, I think that's going to be a common theme throughout the morning as we released the names of these new Bobcats. They're good on the football field, but they're really good in the classroom as well.
I appreciate that, Bill. And yes, let's now turn our attention here to recruiting coordinator Ruben Vaughn here at Texas State. And Coach, welcome to the show. And let's just kind of start with the recruiting process. When does it begin? How do we get to the point that we're at today?
Well, thank you for allowing me to be here. This recruiting process starts long before they become a senior in high school. It really gets started once they pretty much step on the varsity practice, which could be their sophomore year, maybe even their freshman year. So as our coaches go out, do their spring recruiting, or they constantly talk to coaches, you know, high school coaches on the phone and email and get the different types of lists, the recruiting lists, who you have and stuff like that. That's when that process gets started. So when we identify those guys early on in the process, we start following them. In terms of when I say following, we start watching their film, put them on mailing lists and things of that nature so we can start the recruiting process, start to introduce ourselves to them and get to know them a lot better.
When you talk with players, what is it that they're looking for out of a school and out of a program?
Things they're looking for out of a school and program is places they can come and feel comfortable. Can they do well, or can they succeed academically? Can they succeed athletically? Can they come to a place and win a championship? That's what everybody wants to know. Everybody wants the swag, which is going to be the rings, the clothes, this, and that. So, of course, it's always good to have a ring that says conference champion. It's always good to have clothing, an item that says conference champion or something of that nature. So being able to have those things is very important for the young men.
well, you used to be a Division I player yourself, so you know what it's like to compete on the football field, but the recruiting process is competition as well, as you're competing with other schools in the Sun Belt Conference, in the state, in the nation for these players. So when you promote Texas State, what is it about this university that you are promoting over the other schools?
Well, one of the biggest things that we have that we can promote to this university over other schools is by far the closeness that you have, not only just with your teammates, but with our professors as well. We have a great relationship with our professors in terms of students can go by and have office hours, in terms of go to their office hours when they need to talk about something. Teachers are willing to always stay late after class and discuss something, maybe reteach something, a few minutes or something like that. So the closeness that they have with those professors to really get the understanding. Our academic side with Ms. Lori Hansen and our Athletic Academic Center, they do such a phenomenal job. They have with the tutors and things like that, that people that come and help those people really get the skills necessary to succeed academically. So when you have that mixture plus the teammates and coming and doing the things they do around here and the closeness, that stuff to me you just can't beat.
Right, facilities as well. I mean, look at Bobcat Stadium and the improvements that went up about a year ago. The locker room is being redone right now. Yeah. End zone complex where we're at here, one of the best in the Sun Belt Conference. Facilities play a huge role in this as well.
Huge, huge. People love that. Everybody wants to see things about new facilities. So when they, instead of us just having to be able to talk about it, we can actually physically show them the dirt that's being moved. Show them the wood and the concrete that's being busted up and putting back up and stuff like that. So, you know, when you can show them something on paper, yeah, sure, you can sell a dream. But when they actually see it happen, they know it's really taking place.
One of the great things about San Marcos, you hear the term college town. This certainly applies to where we're at right here. Where are some of the hot spots you take recruits when showing them the city of San Marcos and the community?
Well, obviously, you know, you cannot take them to the Alamo. And so what we'll do, we'll give them a little tour in terms of just driving around so they can see where it's at. Then we take them through the city. You know, the city of San Marcos is a beautiful place. And then we just show them the campus. You know, we have so many people that do not know about this campus in terms of when they get here. Oh, I didn't know it looked like this. It's a hidden gem. Yeah, it really is. And so as we get on the campus here, they really fall in love with the place. It's not like we have to try to sell them on the university. When they walk the campus, when they speak with the professors, when they see how friendly the student body is, as they're just walking by and everybody speaking, saying hello, 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 they really get a sense of home. Like, this is a great place to be. And so it sells itself.
Well, Coach, congratulations on what's been a successful 2014 signing class so far. And we look forward to more things from you coming up in the near future.
Awesome. Look forward to it.
All right, we're coming up in a break here on Inside Bobcat Athletics. When we come back, the next reveal and more interviews coming away here on TXTBobcats.com. Good. All right. Thanks again, Coach.
Thanks.
Oh, where did you get Scooter? You went to a lot of basketball games? No way. Can I get one? Oh, go to basketball game? Oh, I'll go.
On behalf of all Texas A&M student athletes, thank you.
Thank you for providing us an opportunity to earn an education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, generosity and support.
Live coverage of signing day 2014 here at Texas. We are live from the end zone complex here at Bobcat Stadium. We're updating the recruiting list here. The next group of signees, we got two more for you. We will start on the offensive line. Tristan Miserac, going to cause some misery for the defensive line of the Sun Belt Conference. You look at Tristan, 6'6", 277, a two-star recruit, according to Rivals.com, at a North Garland High School, and he was a commit back in July, so a very early commit to this program. Some of the schools that the Bobcats are competing with to get his services include Nevada and Rice, and you look, and people talk all the time about offensive linemen are the smartest players on the team. 1400 on the SAT for this guy, so it certainly qualifies there. Let's go ahead and flip the board a bit, and we're going to go to special teams because our next signee is, well, the Bobcats' only special team signee in 2014. That's James Sherman, a kicker. Now, of course, the Bobcats have a couple of kickers with Will Johnson and Jason Dan. They did lose one, however, in Zach Robinson, a punter, at the end of the 2013 season. James Sherman from Montgomery, Alabama, where the Bobcats have recruited before, was also offered to play college football at Tulane, was first-team All-State kicker in the state of Alabama at 5'10", 184 pounds. Also, like Mizorak, who was announced before him, a two-star recruit. And with that, let's talk with special teams coach, linebackers coach here, Brad Franchione, with Bill Colhane.
Thank you very much, Brent. The board is filling up here at the End Zone Comp National Signing Day 2014. Assistant Coach Brad Franchione joins us. Coach Franchione in charge of the linebackers here at Texas State, along with being the special teams coordinator. And, Coach, as we look at our big board here at the End Zone Complex, let's talk about Darnell Daly. What do you know? What can you tell us about that linebacker?
Well, Darnell was an extensive evaluation on who we wanted to go with out of the junior college ranks. Darnell came to the top. He's a unique combination of size and speed. Has jumped in and really done a tremendous job so far just in the first few weeks he's been here. But he's got tremendous ability to play in space, which is so much of what linebackers have to do in this day and age. And so speed is not going to be an issue, change of direction. We're working on getting him stronger, but all those things make him a tremendous. And you know, he's a great person. He comes from a great family, two parents live in Fairfield, California, and you know, they're a supportive group of people, and you can see why Darnell is such a great person, because when you meet his parents, they're tremendous people.
And Coach, we go to the special team side of things. The Bobcats have been very good in special teams the last few years, whether it be the coverage units, the return game, the kicking game. And Brant pointed out a couple of really good kickers coming back for Texas State. What can you tell us about James Sherman and what his potential looks like here at Texas State?
Well, James works on all three phases. He's a kicker, a punter, and a field goal kicker. He was 17 for 25 in his career as a high school kicker. I think his long was 49. He's got the unique ability to do all three, which is hard to find, and was rated highly in all three areas. I think he had 86% of his kickoffs in high school were touchbacks, which kind of goes hand in hand with what we've been accustomed to with what we have here. And he had a 42-yard average his senior year as a punter. So he offers some fake ability. He had two rushes, averaged 18 yards a rush. And so he has some athletic ability as well, and the ability to perform all three is really a unique characteristic in specialists. In this day and age, you have a lot of people who can punt but have a hard time kicking off the ground, or you have people who can kick off the ground but aren't real adept at punting. And James offers all three of those. With where we're at, I think he's got a chance to step in and learn from Jason and Will and be a great future Bobcat for us.
And Coach, before we sign any Bobcats, before the letter of intents come in through the fax machine, you have to have relationships with coaches. Talk about that process with high school coaches, with JUCO coaches, letting them know that they can trust Texas State.
Well, that's an important aspect of recruiting, because the high school coaches, especially in this state, want to know where you're at in your recruiting process. Have you offered? How long the offer is going to be there, and in the same breath, they give you information that you need to know as far as character references, who to speak to in the school as far as teachers, just to get to know the kids and how they're like outside of football, in the football program, what kind of leadership they offer. So it's a constant exchange of information, and the high school coaches in Texas for sure, they have a definite desire to know exactly who's recruiting their players and what step in the process they are. And a lot of times they can tell you what the kids are telling them as far as you have a chance to get this kid. They really liked your school and those kind of things. And the junior college ranks, when you go to Northern California, the junior college coaches are available and they know their kids. They they don't necessarily want to know all the details. So you really have to spend a lot of time with the player and his parents, and then you do your best to keep the coach informed, because he has so many kids normally at a two-year college that are getting recruited. Sometimes it's more than the coach can manage. So you usually try to find an assistant coach on staff at a junior college that is taking care of that individual student athlete and keep him informed, because him and that athlete are usually in day-to-day contact, whereas the head coach may not be.
All right. Well, Coach, obviously we're doing a great job here at Texas State in building, nurturing, growing those relationships. I know it's been a busy morning. Congratulations on what is starting to be a tremendous National Signing Day here at Texas State.
And I want to thank you guys for coming out today, and you guys make this stuff special and important, and appreciate all the hard work you guys do.
You bet. Okay, Bobcat fans, let's turn it over to Brant Freeman.
All right, thanks, Bill. And we're going to take a look at Devondrick Dixon, who's a cornerback, Texas State. So add somebody here to the defense. And you look at Dixon from Gilmer High School, committed in the summer in June, a notable two-way player, played corner and wide receiver. And we just heard from Brad Franchione, the special teams coach here. Well, Dixon actually returned kicks and punts in high school, so maybe could be somebody to look to in the return game in the coming years here at Texas State, and a two-star recruit as well, by the way. So again, that is Devondrick Dixon, our latest signee added to the big board here on our live coverage on TXDBobcast.com. We're coming up on a break. When we come back, Bill will introduce your next signees. More interviews coming your way. We will speak with Jason Johnson, receivers coach, coming up here on TXDBobcats.com.
Okay.
They're getting your attention. They just wanted to...
We play for mothers.
We play for sisters.
We play for aunts.
We play for all the women in the county.
We play for you.
Please join the Cat Fight for Breast Cancer on February 8th. We'll be tipping off 2 o'clock at the Rage Agents. If you work a game, you'll get free admission.
If you'd like to help us funds towards breast cancer, please visit www.txstatebobcats.com/auction to start bidding online today and help a very good cause for our mothers, our daughters, our aunts, and the women that we love dearly.
Welcome back to the End Zone Complex at Bobcat Stadium. Happy to have you on board for National Signing Day 2014. When Brant and I started the show earlier this morning, we talked about getting some depth in the trenches, getting some offensive linemen, getting some defensive linemen. Well, I predict by the time you have your first bite of your lunch this afternoon, you're going to feel really good about the Bobcat defensive line and offensive line. Well, let's start on the offensive side of the line. Keon Schoenborn, 6'4", 290-pound offensive lineman from Jacksonville, Florida, from the Bowles High School. And you talk about a guy who is a road grader. He absolutely does a tremendous job of clearing the way for running backs and protecting his quarterback. So he joins Miserac along the offensive front. And again, Bobcat fans are going to be happy when they see Schoenborn out there. And now we go back over to the defensive side of the ball, and a defensive lineman who's done a tremendous job in earning a scholarship to Texas State. And our first defensive end that we put up on the board is Cody Casey, a 6'4", 255-pound defensive end right from here in the Lone Star State from Dawson High School in Pearland, Texas. One of the top 100 recruits in the Houston area, according to the Houston Chronicle, is Cody Casey. And now we turn it over to Brant Freeman along with Bobcat assistant coach Jason Johnson. And Coach Johnson, knows a lot about these student athletes.
All right, thanks, Bill. And yes, here we are with receivers coach Jason Johnson. And Bill brought up a really good point talking about the last recruit he just revealed from Houston. You look, and there's so many recruiting territories for a school like Texas State here in the state of Texas. Houston, Dallas, San Antonio, Austin. They need to get outside of the state of Texas as well. They're recruiting territories beyond the Lone Star State. Coach, if you can't break down for us, which is your particular territory and why is it so important?
Well, my territory is West Texas. I have basically everything west of 281, including Stephenville, all the way up in far west. And it's important to us to go out there and recruit and have a name of Texas State even out west in Texas, because there are some gems that are in West Texas. I haven't lived there before. My wife is from out in that area. I know that there are guys out of the Abilene, Lubbock, Shallow Water, Amarillo, all those areas that are diamonds in the rough that we love to follow up on and make Bobcats if it's the right fit.
Now, looking at the state of Texas alone, there are thousands of high schools, which means there are tens of thousands of players out there. How do you know who exactly to go look for and go about finding them?
Well, you have to do your homework. You have to go out there and visit schools and get information and watch film yourself. Huddle has been a great access for us to be able to do that, and we can get a lot of film work in before we even kind of hit the roads to anticipate who's available, who's where, and get that information. And the high school coaches do a great job of promoting their kids and telling us about their kids, and they want to see them succeed, and this is the best state of coaches that that do that.
What's it like for you to visit a recruit?
It's awesome. It's awesome. Meeting the recruit, meeting his family, meeting the coaches, the teachers, all those who are involved in that kid's life. It's an awesome experience in meeting them and having those relationships outside of the 4 or 5 years that you know the kid means a lot, and it goes a long way.
You know, it wasn't that long ago where the roles were reversed and you were being recruited to play college football. What do you remember about that experience, and how has it helped you doing the job that you do now?
Well, I do remember it. It was interesting not knowing who necessarily may be interested in me from that standpoint, but building a relationship with the coach, and I understand as a coach, it's important to build that relationship with the kid. Not so much of them just coming to your school, but knowing more about them, what they like, what they dislike, being involved with who their family is, and in that aspect has really helped me understand that better, being on the other side of it not too long ago.
Well, of course, recruiting is a huge part of your job, but your title is receivers coach here at Texas State, and I think Bill brought the term earlier that it is Christmas in February today. So for you, your lone gift under the tree, PJ Anderson, at wide receiver. What are your thoughts about this kid?
Love PJ. PJ committed to us early and never wavered. I commend him for his loyalty and his word. I know we do as a staff and as a program. Tremendous family. Love being with him. I know he's going to be outstanding for us in what we do. I know he's going to be successful in the classroom. He's successful as a person, and I can't wait to have him a part of our receiving core to help this program go forward.
Looking at the position, you're losing Andy Erickson and Isaiah Battle. Between those two, 142 catches, 1,775 yards, 13 touchdowns, now gone from the roster. You're adding P.J. Anderson, and also, let's not forget, you're really adding two new players next year as well in Damon Mercer and Bryce Gunter.
Yes, we do have those guys that are chomping at the bit, I know, to get in here and get going, be a part of the mix. I'm excited about what they are going to be able to bring to our team. And Jafus Gaines and Brandon Smith and Ben Aja have done a great job as kind of the seniors and juniors of the group to really bring those guys underneath their wing and kind of show them the way and help the transition to become very easy for them.
All right. Thanks, Coach, again for all your time. Looking forward to the coming season.
Thank you.
All right. Then again, receivers coach Jason Johnson joining us here on TXDBobcast.com. Coming up on another break, we come back the next set of reveals and another interview coming up as our live coverage of signing day continues. Welcome back to Signing Day 2014 here from the End Zone Complex at Texas State. Our live coverage continues on TXTBobcats.com. We're updating the big board, and we're going to the big guys on the defensive line. That is D tackle. And let's start with Mershad Dillon. And he comes from Allen Hancock Community College, committed this past January. Notably, he spent his freshman season at Fresno State, then transferred to junior college, comes in at 6'3", 300 pounds. Another D-tackle in his class, Dondre Elvoid. You look at Dondre, 6'3", 301, so kind of the similar size. Also, a JUCO transfer from Garden City Community College. And again, defensive line, a huge need for the Bobcats going into the signing class, losing Blake McCulloch, DJ Injury, Jordan Norfleet, Jamie Clavelle Head. Between those four players, over 100 games, over 260 tackles, 30 tackles for loss, 13 sacks. That's a lot to replace. And to talk about the defensive line, Bill's got an interview coming up with Kyle Tatum.
Thank you very much, Brandon. We are joined by Bobcat assistant coach, defensive tackles coach here at Texas State, Kyle Tatum. Coach, I know it's an exciting day. Thanks for joining us this morning. The end of a lot of hard work. First of all, speaking of hard work, let's talk about your growth here at Texas State. You came to Texas State as a graduate assistant. A year ago, you were a full-fledged assistant coach. Talk about that transition from a personal standpoint.
Well, it's been a great blessing. I mean, it really has. GA'd here 2 years ago for Coach Fran, and he hired me on in the spring. And just thrilled to keep working and then trying to build this interior front to a Division I standard and get some sacks, most definitely.
You, of course, come from the state of Alabama, played your college football for the Crimson Tide, and certainly the Bobcats have done their fair share of recruiting here in the state of Texas, also in California, but in Alabama as well. Talk about how important it is from a recruiting standpoint, you know, to go anywhere to look for the best football players.
Well, there's no doubt, the top talent comes from the state of Texas. But, you know, sometimes we find players out of state that are special players, guys that we can't get off of that are very, very solid contributors to our program. Just for example, Brandon Smith out of Alabama, we took 2 years ago. He's been a solid player, solid all Sun Belt player. It's definitely a good thing to venture out of state sometimes to complete your football team and fill some voids that you need.
Coach, hold on 1 second. Getting word that we've got another new Bobcat. Brant, what do you have for us here?
Well, we're staying on the defensive line at defensive tackle, Tony Pulu. And we mentioned recruiting territories. Well, Tony Pulu is actually out of the Arizona area from Mesa Community College, committed again last month in January. 6'3", 300 pounds, in JUCO last year at the defensive tackle position, 70 tackles, 8 sacks. And remember, defensive tackle position, not one which lends itself to a lot of sacks. 8 in a JUCO season is a big number. And think about the schools the Bobcats were competing to get his services. Utah State, we've seen what their program has become, and a couple of Sun Belt schools as well, Troy and South Alabama. Sorry, Trojans, sorry, Jaguars. Tony Pulu is a Bobcat.
Thanks, Brand. Coach Tatum, 6'3", 300 pounds. I like the sound of that. I like those numbers. Is there anything you can add about the young man?
You know what, Coach? Tremendous twitch off the football. Got a great get off. All these guys are 300-pound guys, 290 guys, guys that can hold up in the interior and take on double teams and work off guards and make plays flat down the line of scrimmage. We're excited about all three. Tony's a great addition. He's a hybrid guy. Could also play defensive end for us. And really excited about Mashad and Dondre bringing a 300-pound force to the interior, no doubt. That makes my job easier, most definitely.
All right, Coach. Well, I know we're not even halfway through with the new Bobcats up here on the big board, but congratulations, an exciting day to be a Bobcat. Appreciate you coming by.
Yes, sir. No problem. Thank you, guys.
All right, Bobcat assistant coach Kyle Tatum. We're going to pause for a moment. Don't go anywhere, Bobcat fans. When we come back, we'll introduce you to some more new Bobcats here at Texas State. Back in a moment, 2014. Welcome back to the End Zone Complex at Bobcat Stadium on TXDayBobcats.com, National Signing Day 2014. One thing that has been a prevailing theme throughout the morning is get bigger, stronger, better offensive line, defensive line. Well, here with the most recent LOIs, the Bobcats have taken a couple of huge, emphasis huge, strides in that regard. I've got a couple of offensive linemen for you. We'll start with one young man not going away from home very far to play his college ball, Westlake Chaparral, Will Copa, offensive lineman, 6'8", 310-pounder from Austin, led the Chaparrals to the state semifinals as a junior, first-team all-district selection as a junior and a senior, 43 pancake blocks as a senior, a guy who I guess loves syrup with his pancakes or something like that. But anyway, Will Copa, welcome to San Marcos. So you can see the offensive line is really growing here at Texas State, and that's a segue where we've got another new Bobcat here, Cannon Mackey, offensive lineman, 6'4", 288-pounder from Silsby High School in Silsby, Texas. Look at his accolades, first-team All-District as a junior and a senior, was a second-team All-District pick as a sophomore, did not give up a sack in 12 games. I know Tyler Jones and the rest of the Bobcat quarterbacks love to hear that. So let's add another offensive lineman here to the fold at Texas State. You look at these four young men, check this out. An average of 6'5.5", 292 pounds, and they haven't even spent a day in Blake Cundiff's strength and conditioning program. And now we send it over to Brand Freeman, who's visiting with a Bobcat coach who has to be very, very happy this morning.
And a new face as well. Thanks, Bill. And now joining us, offensive line coach Brad Bedell. And you know, coach, today is all about recruiting, about getting these young players to come here to commit to play football at Texas State. Well, let's talk about your recruiting process. How is it that you ended up as a Bobcat?
Well, we finished the bowl game, the GoDaddy. And then I had the opportunity to come here and just talk some football with the staff and things that we did at Arkansas State. And turned out they went really well. when Coach Shaw went to Houston, I got a call and by Coach Francione and asked me if I'd be interested in this job. And I said, absolutely. He offered it. I took it. I canceled going to the National Coaches Convention. There was no reason to go anymore. Helped my friend the house for the move, and here I am.
Well, let's get right to the bones of it. What are your philosophies when coaching offensive linemen?
Physical, no question. We're going to be a physical football team. If you're not a really physical football player, it's going to be a long haul with me. I've told that our current players when I've met with them. That's what we're going to do. We're going to run the football field. You're going to have a passion of being physical. We're going to be technically sound and be accountable.
Now, you yourself were All-American at Colorado. You played 6 years in the National Football League. Given that you're not far removed from when you played football, how are you able to relate to this generation of player?
I think just talking to them, getting to know them. Sit down with the players and have a genuine interest in who they are as people, not as football players. The common goal in that offensive line room is football. We wouldn't be here if we didn't have the desire to win championships. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm here. That's why the staff is here. And we need to get to know each other other than that. If there's a passion and a common bond other than football, we're going to play 10 times harder, we're going to be 10 times more physical, and when it gets tough, we'll turn to each other and we'll get it done.
Now, Coach, you know, we're glancing at a big board, and Bill just announced two of the latest signees, both offensive linemen, Tristan Mizorak, Keon Schoenborn, Will Copa, Cannon Mackey. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on this group of signees?
Good class. Tall, longer. They're all four extremely physical. You know, Tristan has played center and tackle in high school. He's a big, long kid. Keon has played for three state championships at Bowles School. Three. One. Comes from a winning tradition. Their head high school coach has won 400 games. That's big. He comes in wanting to win. That's important. Will Copa, Austin, huge. Just a big kid. Moves well, physical, brings length to us. You know, Cannon Mackey is a player that committed to us really early. Mom has connections here. She came to Southwest Texas. Dad played in the NFL for a long time, played quarterback. He's a coach's kid. And just a good athlete, moves well. I'm excited to have all four.
And you know, we're talking about Will Copa. Austin Wesley kids have been are always highly sought after when in the state. Not too many have played at Texas State. He's a huge get. You look at the pedigree of that high school program. Drew Brees, Nick Foles, Justin Tucker, all former Austin Westlake Chaparrals. Well, getting back to the offensive line, that's the new breed coming in. But you have a lot of old blood that's going to be here at the start of the 2014 season. Charlie Will Tuttle, who's a very versatile offensive lineman. Adrian Ballard, who'll be a junior. Been playing very well in his 2 years out of Brenham. A couple of redshirt freshmen from a year ago are back this coming season, Felix Romero amongst them. What are your thoughts on the returning offensive linemen?
Just excited to work with them. You know, spring ball can't get here soon enough. But, you know, right now I want to concentrate on the weight room and getting in better shape and stronger. That's the focus right now. Let us get through this recruiting. Now we'll dive into football and have an opportunity to move on from there. But I've talked to these guys to live in the moment. The moment right now is to get as strong as you possibly can before we start spring ball. That happens, we're going to get better as a unit in spring, take advantage of those 15 practices. And I told them there isn't a waiting period. We're going to hit the ground running. This is going to be a heavyweight battle. We're not going to feel each other out. These are the goals. This is how it's going to work and buy in, and it's going to be an easy transition.
All right, well, again, offensive line coach Brad Bedell, first-year Bobcat amongst many that we're introducing today. Glad to have you on board.
Me too. Thank you very much.
All right, coming up at a break here on TXTBobcast.com. When we come back, the next set of reveals as our coverage of Signing Day 2014 continues. Welcome back to our live coverage of Signing Day 2014 here from the End Zone Complex at Bobcat Stadium, online at txtbobcast.com. Brant Freeman here with you in a moment. We'll kick things over to Bill alongside running backs coach Jeff Conway. But first, we're updating the big board, and we're starting on the defensive line and going to defensive end Cedric Gambrell. You look at this kid, 6'6", 242. That is a great frame for the defensive end position. Out of Cleveland, Texas, a two-star recruit. Also had offers to go to UNT and SMU, so the Bobcats were competing against in-state universities for his services. And something interesting about Cedric Gambrell, actually, he played defensive end only 1 year. His senior year before that was on the offensive line, so a versatile player in the trenches. Let's flip the big board here and go to offense, and this will be a really nice transition after the squeaking goes away with Coach Conway coming up, because we're looking at the Bobcats' lone running back signee of 2014. That is Stedman Mayberry. And you look at Stedman, he comes from Cedar Park Vista Ridge, a very good program in the North Austin area. Also offers at Ohio University, Rice, and Yale, so you know he's smart. He ranked amongst the top 20 running backs in the state of Texas this past year, listed at 5'9", 185 pounds, also a two-star recruit. So to talk about these two players, and Gambrell is one that Coach Conway recruited, here's Bill.
Thanks, Brandon. It is Jeff Conway, Bobcat running backs coach, co-offensive coordinator here at Texas State. First of all, Coach, congratulations. Know it's been a very hectic, very busy morning. Appreciate you joining us. And let's do what Brant said. First of all, you know, talk about adding to the defensive line recruit that you were very familiar with in Gambrell.
Cedric's, you know, he's kind of a late bloomer because he was real thin his junior year. He was about 218 pounds. And because he moved to defensive line, he went to offensive line kind of out of necessity. He always wanted to play defensive end and finally got the opportunity. He did actually play both his junior year, but was full-time defensive end, and that's what we recruited him as. And we kind of thought all along that if he was anything like his older brother, Cedric Reed is the starting defensive end for the Longhorns, that we had a good one.
One thing that the Bobcat fans might not be aware of, you know, they hear me introduce you and I say running backs coach, offensive coordinator, Jeff Conway, and they may be thinking, hey, why is Coach Conway out recruiting a defensive end? Talk about how it's broken up and how it's not necessarily an offensive coach recruiting offensive guys, defensive coaches recruiting defensive guys.
Yeah, different staffs do it different ways, but more often than not, all nine coaches, all nine assistants have a recruiting area to begin with. Mine happens to be East Houston out to Beaumont, north to the Livingston, Jasper area, and then the Kansas junior colleges. Well, that's how it begins, and then it ends up going by position a lot of times too. Whereas in this case, you know, Mike Hudson and Kyle Tatum were able to help. And the recruiting is always a collective effort. It's not just one guy who signs a kid and that he just the point man, is to be honest with you.
And now we look at the board and running back. Only one running back in this class so far. Stedman Mayberry, a kid out of the greater Austin metropolitan area, just revealed Will Copa, a Westlake Chaparral there in the Austin area. So obviously Coach Fran, the staff, are taking a look at the local kids in Central Texas. You bring back a lot of depth, a lot of talent at the running back position. Rob Lowe, all Sunbelt Conference performer, Chris Nuttall, Tim Gay, Terrence Franks, a lot of depth there. What is Stedman Mayberry going to have to do to prepare himself to be a running back for this Texas State offense?
Well, I think he's already on the right track. I think the future is bright with Stedman in the fold now as the single young running back we have. We do have quite a few older running backs in, I believe, four juniors and one senior. But we're excited to get him because, you know, he's going to have to learn the offense, first of all. He's got to get, you know, always the recruiting story is get bigger, faster, and stronger. And when I say bigger, when he came on his visit, he was 190 pounds. He's 5'10", 5'9". That's fine. We just always ask our players to show up as the strongest they've ever been in their life and the fastest they've ever been in their life, whatever that is. He's got an excellent base. His dad is a high school coach at Bastrop High School, and so he hears it at home a lot too. He's already, I think, a student of the game because when we met on the official visits, he was asking a lot of good football questions. So I think his IQ is high in that regard. So he's got a good start already. I'm really excited that he jumped in the fold this summer and committed and then stuck with it. We always love those guys who stick with their commitments all the way through recruiting.
High academics, high character kind of kid as well. And that has been a prevailing theme so far this morning with more Bobcats to come. That's not by accident, is it?
No, the message here at Texas State is different than a lot of other universities we recruit against. We're not just interested in a football player. We want kids who are encouraged about having a great college experience. And to do that, you got to start out by you got to have a burning desire to get a college degree. And the majority of these kids that we're involved with, especially in the culmination today, is that these kids all want that. Stedman certainly fits into that category because he is academically inclined. He's already announced that he's going to major in economics in college. And those are the kind of guys that we want in our program. Those are Texas State fits for us. And not everybody is that. But those kids who want a great education and want to play football at a high level and want to enjoy college, this is the place to be.
It is, Coach. Congratulations. A great start to the morning. I know you've kind of been leading the cheers. I've been hearing you screaming there, your voice a little hoarse there. It has been an exciting morning. I'll let you get back to the cheering. Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you very much.
All right, again, Jeff Conway, a proud Bobcat coach this morning. We're going to pause for a moment. When we come back, we'll return here to the End Zone Complex. More Bobcats on the horizon, Bobcat fans. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in a moment. We're back again, and we've got a couple of more Bobcats here to put up on the big board. It's National Signing Day 2014, and I woke up this morning, Brant, I think you woke up this morning wondering, gosh, what are the Bobcats going to do about the defensive line? As we left the game in Troy, Alabama, the final game of the regular season, you saw all those defensive linemen who were no longer going to be playing for the Bobcats. Well, I feel better already. I feel even better right now. Let's put a couple more Bobcats up on the big board. Let's start with Steven Eddings, a defensive end, 6'4", 285-pounder out of Memphis, Tennessee, first-team all-conference at Jones County Junior College, a two-year starter there at Jones. A very good program, by the way. Many of you familiar with the JUCO football scene, I know you've heard of Jones County JC. And he was coached there by Ray Perkins. Name rings a bell, of course, longtime guy in the NFL, also the head coach at the University of Alabama once upon a time. So here is Steven Eddings. Add him to a very crowded defensive end slot here up on the big board. And we're going to stay right there, folks. I know you're cheering. I can hear you out there. Brian Gwindling, a defensive end, 6'4", 235-pounder from Poway, California, played his JUCO ball at Palomar Community College. Look at some of his numbers here. He started out his career at Nevada, former player for the Wolfpack. At Palomar, he was first-team all-conference, all-region, set a school record, hello opposing quarterbacks, a school record 15 quarterback sacks as a senior. His father, Mike, played for the San Diego Chargers in the NFL, so obviously there's some bloodlines there. There's some pedigree. So let's put Brian Gwindling, a new Texas State Bobcat, put him right here on the defensive end side of things. And now, Brant, I turn it over to you. And as I stare at Mike Hudson, defensive line coach, I think I see a twinkle in his eye. Is that a smile?
You bet it is.
It's both. And by the way, we look at the big board, seven players on the defensive line. And we touched upon it earlier, the Bobcats having lost so much on the defensive line at the end of 2013, as Bill alluded to when things were done in Troy. So, Coach, given that, how important was it to recruit the position in this signing class?
This was a primary position for us. You got to win football games up front. We lost a lot of good players, and we feel like we've replaced them with some very good players, guys that can come in and play right away.
You look at the guys on the big board, defensive end, defensive tackle, about average 6'4 in height, 300 pounds in the interior. You get to the outside, about 250 from your defensive ends. How much are you looking forward to working with players that size?
Well, it's awesome, you know, especially the height. That's one thing we've lacked around here is the height. We get some PBUs and the length, and to work around the edge. So we're very excited about the height and the weight of these guys.
So pass breakups, PBUs, by the way, for those who wanted to know what the term means, are nice, but a lot of people relate defensive ends to sacks. How much do you feel like this group of players can get to the quarterback.
I feel great about it. I slept with a smile on my face last night. Brian has 15 in one season. Steven can work the edge. Cedric is going to be a great pass rusher here, as will Cody. All these guys are good pass rushers.
And when we look at the interior, Rashad Dillon, Dondre Elvoy, Tony Pulu could be huge run stoppers.
Huge. Good size in there, big bodies. 300 pounders that we don't have a lot of right now. So, I mean, this is huge. Signing these guys in the defensive line is a big, big deal.
Yeah, and given the fact that you did lose so much from a year ago, is there a sense that this group can compete for starting jobs in 2014?
There's no question. That's why they're recruited.
Well, fair enough. But take us through the recruiting process for your coach and where your territory was and some of the players that you personally recruited and how you felt things worked out for yourself.
Well, things are fine. I recruited in the North Dallas area, signed Tristan Mizurek. Had a few other guys that were on, and things work one way and they work another way. But we're developing relationships up there in Dallas, and we're going to be fine.
Bill spoke with Coach Conaway about it and how position coaches will recruit outside of their position. You mentioned Tristan Mizurek. As a defensive line coach, what do you see out of an offensive lineman?
Well, you look for height and length. You look for potential, and then you identify the player, and then you take him to the position coach, and then he tells you yes or no, and then you take off on the recruiting trail. But you know how, when you've done this for a while, you kind of know what things to look for. Feet, for example, does he stay on top? Is he a leaner, or does he keep his shoulders back? Those types of deals.
Well, Coach, again, great recruiting class, particularly on the defensive line. I know a huge emphasis. Job well done. We look forward to the start of spring ball coming up later this month.
Great. Thank you, guys. Go Cats.
All right. More coverage coming up here of signing day 2014 on TXDBobcats.com.
We play for mothers.
We play for sisters.
We play for aunts.
We play for all the women in this county.
We play for you.
Join the Bobcat Fight for Cancer Awareness on February 8th. We'll be kicking off 2 o'clock against the Raging Cajun. If you wear pink to the game, you'll be a mission. If you'd like to help raise funds towards breast cancer awareness, please visit www.txstatebobcats.com/auction to start bidding online today and help a very worthy cause for our mothers, our daughters, our aunts, and the women that we love dearly.
Welcome back to our live coverage of signing day 2014 here on TXDBobcats.com. We're coming to you again live from the end zone complex here at Bobcat Stadium. In a moment, Bill will be visiting with Mariano Rivera of this recruiting coaching staff, and that's Jason Washington, they call him the closer here. And so with Jay Wash coming up, we're going to look at the secondary here at Texas State. We'll start at the cornerback position, Andrew Aniki, a 6'1", 172 corner from Ridgepoint High School. He committed back in October here at Texas State, also had offers at Nevada and New Mexico. His past season, 46 tackles, but really had his hands on the football a ton. 16 pass breakups. Remember, a high school football regular season is 10 games and 3 interceptions. That's impressive. So let's also stay in the secondary and go to the safety position. The first of a few safeties we'll see today is Frankie Griffin. Now remember, the Bobcats lost 2 safeties at the end of the 2013 season. And Aaron Matthews and Justin Awuji, this was certainly a huge area of need for the Cats going into the 2014 signing class. Talking more about Griffin, 6 feet, 180-pound, 2-star recruit out of Klein Collins High School, a very good program. Just like Aniki, committed in October. I had offers out of the Big 12 from Iowa State, Colorado State, and Fresno State as well. Two-time all-district player, and he was named the team's defensive MVP in 2013. So with that, with the announcements of Griffin and Aniki, let's kick things over to Bill and Coach Washington.
Thank you, Bran. We're joined by Jason Washington, our cornerbacks coach here at Texas State. Many of you, of course, remember Coach Washington, a Bobcat great, not only on the gridiron, but also for the baseball team. And first of all, Coach, I want to say congratulations on what has started out to be a tremendous day for Bobcat Nation, for the Maroon and Gold faithful. And let's talk a little bit about the fact that you played here. You were a student athlete here in San Marcos. How does that help you when you're out on the recruiting trail?
I think it gives me a little bit of an unfair advantage, I guess. I'm familiar with this area, being from San Antonio. This place has been great for me. Just the opportunities that you will get from just the people that are around, the student body, of course, the administration, and the professors. It's great. I mean, I think I got a firsthand knowledge to help our recruits out to understand what Texas State has to offer. So I enjoyed my time here, and hopefully I can help some of those guys realize and make their dreams come true at Texas State.
You heard Brant mention you're known as the closer here. You're not given that nickname. You earn something like the closer. What does that mean?
You know, it means a lot. I think those high school coaches do an unbelievable job, and the relationships that you make are tremendous. Those young men and the parents got to trust you. And so being in this area and being familiar with those high school coaches and a lot of people around here really, really helped. And it's our entire coaching staff. I think they're all big closers. I try to nitpick and get a little bit from all those guys and then kind of be able to work from there and see what's going to be my best niche.
You're also the cornerbacks coach here at Texas State. A year ago, you had to replace Daryl Morris, who, of course, is now a San Francisco 49er in the NFL. Xavier Daniels, who was a true Bobcat, is, of course, done with his eligibility. I look at the big board, Dixon, Aniki, what are they going to add to the cornerback position?
Both those guys are tremendous ball players. If you pop on their film, you could see them flying around. First starting with Andrew, he came to our camp. He can really, really run. This game has changed with receivers being so big. He's a six-foot corner that we've always been looking for and waiting on to get. And he came to camp, ran a 4.41. His change of direction was tremendous. Ball skills are great. And so I was fired up when he said that he wanted to commit and be a Bobcat. And just personally being able to work with him really, really excited me. And he's going to make me a better coach. With Frankie, he's kind of the same thing. You kind of look at his size is great, his speed, tenacity. He loves to play the ball, loves to play football, and that's what we like. Yeah, I think it's funny. I told him he's got a linebacker mentality into a safety. He'll come down and strike you. His change of direction is great. We're excited about those two young men.
And, you think back, and Brant pointed out, Justin Awuji, of course, no longer a Bobcat. We've run out of Awuji brothers here at Texas State. And Aaron Matthews, it seemed like Aaron always brought a baseball bat to the tackle.
Definitely
should be. A hard hitter. Uh-huh. That's kind of the mindset we're trying to get on the defensive side of the ball, isn't it, where the word finesse is out of the equation.
That's true. I think those guys set the tone to a defense. You always talk about being physical. We want to be a physical defense, and for that to happen, you got to have physical ball players that love to fly around and throw their body around. And with those guys and the rest of our recruiting class, I think we got that.
What are high school coaches saying about Texas State when you and the rest of the coaches walk in the room?
They always say it's a hidden gem. This place is special. Once you step on campus, you'll fall in love with it. You'll fall in love with the people, the environment, the student body, and big and great things are happening down in San Marvelous.
All right, Coach, you're right. A lot of great things happening here in San Marvelous, including National Signing Day 2014. Folks, it's turned out to be a great day, a better day than I could have hoped for here with our big board. So, Coach, thanks for sitting in.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Go enjoy the rest of your day and keep closing.
You know I will. Thank
okay.
you.
We're going to step aside. We'll be back with more National Signing Day 2014. Don't go anywhere. You're watching TXStateBobcats.com.
On behalf of all the state student athletes, we want to say thank you.
Thank you for providing us an opportunity to earn education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We thank you for your generosity and support.
And welcome back to TXTBobcast.com for our coverage of signing day 2014. In just a moment, Bill will have a conversation with defensive coordinator Craig Nivar here at the end zone complex. We're updating the big board first, and we'll go with safeties, which is, of course, is Coach Nivar's specialty. And adding to the big board here, Stephon Johnson. What's the most exciting play of football? One of the more exciting plays, the pick six, right? Stephon had three of them in high school this past year, playing out of the Woodlands College Park High School, 6 feet, 183 pounds, and a two-star recruit. Also at the safety position, Cameron Brown, 5'10", 191 pounds, out of Ridgepoint High School. That's the second Bobcat we've announced from that particular high school program. As a senior this past year, 61 tackles, 5 interceptions, 2 pass breakups, and a forced fumble. So you talk about safeties, and what Coach Nivar loves about the position are guys who swarm into the football. Stephon Johnson, Cameron Brown would qualify.
Thank you, Brandon. Now we are joined by Bobcat defensive coordinator and safeties coach, Craig Nivar, and Coach Coach Washington kind of broke down Frankie Griffin, but I'd like to hear your analysis about Johnson, about Brown. What do they bring to the table?
Both of those young men are really smart football players. They both have a tremendous knack for the game. They have high GPAs in the classroom. They're smart football players on the field. In their defensive systems, they were asked to make a lot of checks on the field and do some things like that, which we're going to ask even more of that from those guys. So not only are they playmakers, they're smart football players too, and that shows up with their production.
We're not done yet. The board isn't complete, but we're here looking at the defense and kind of look at this not just as a defensive coordinator but as a Bobcat football fan. As you look at the depth the Bobcats are adding, what are your thoughts?
Well, there are some names that we'll get up. You'll put up there as we go. This is far and away the best defensive line class we've signed. There's bulk, there's size, there's nasty. That's going to really help us going forward as we have to push forward to that next level within the Sun Belt Conference and in Division I level. So that is a huge get right there. Darnell Daly had speed at the backer position, which we're constantly going after. Adding three safeties, adding three corners, builds depth at those positions that we use a lot on special teams, not just in our packages on defense, but also increasing our special team speed and depth.
Going into the 2013 season, the Bobcats' first season, of course, in the Sun Belt Conference, coming off the year in the WAC, a couple of things that we talked about, the defense needing is you had to get more pressure on the quarterback, and the Bobcats had to continue to do a good job in the giveaway, takeaway department. In my opinion, both of those things were addressed for the most part in 2013. As you look into the crystal ball, going into spring ball and ultimately the 2014 season, what do the Bobcats need to get better at defensively?
Well, we made a huge emphasis going into last season on improving our run defense. I believe we finished first in the conference in run defense. We didn't play as well in some of the bigger games as we had liked, and that's a continual push to play better against Lafayette and Arkansas State and people like that, that are the top edge of the conference right now. We addressed getting better on third downs. We addressed getting better in the red zone. And we felt like we did better in all those, but we're not where we need to be. And some of these young men help us, and the work we'll put in now during the offseason spring ball will help us parallel that, get to that point.
As we look at the defensive line, and there will be more names to be added, you see some JUCO players there. Am I to assume, or Bobcat fans to assume, that these are guys that you expect to be ready from day one going forward?
Yeah, when we sign a junior college player, for the most part, we expect that young man to come in and play immediately. We were fortunate enough last year with some safeties and defensive backs we signed because of depth. We kind of projected forward to redshirt those guys, and now we'll have those guys go forward. But up front, the majority of these guys we expect to be on the field getting after game one.
Final thing, Coach, and I'm going to take it, go away from National Signing Day for a moment. As you walk up the stairs here at the end zone complex, you see a picture of Joplo Bartu, Atlanta Falcons, Daryl Morris, San Francisco 49ers, Fred Evans, Minnesota Vikings, three former Bobcats who played for you here at Texas State. Has to make you feel good.
No doubt. That's exciting. Those young men got their opportunity and made the most of it, and it just feels good to be a small part of what those young men have become, and we're extremely proud of them.
All right, Coach, you used the word nasty. We'll be looking for nasty from the Bobcat defense in 2014.
With a capital N.
All right, Craig Nivar, your defensive coordinator here at Texas State. It's National Signing Day 2014. We'll pause for a moment. When we come back, we'll have more right here on the home of Bobcat Athletics, TXStateBobcats.com. Where's camera? Okay. Welcome back again to the End Zone Complex here at Bobcat Stadium. Won't be long. Spring ball starts the end of this month, but now today we're trying to fill up the big board here at Texas State. And it's been a common theme today. We've been talking about the defensive line, and we're going to add another name, another big fella, Roosevelt Pearson, a 6'5", 255-pound defensive end out of Paris, California, played his JUCO ball at San Jacinto College. And you look at some of his numbers, 31 tackles, 17 solo stops for Pearson, had 2.5 quarterback sacks, at a guy who plays behind the line of scrimmage, had 8.5 tackles for loss, 39 yards lost on those tackles for loss. He led the team in that department. So another defensive end, Brant, our big board, is filling up with D lineman, friend.
Absolutely, and a big need for the Cats, as we alluded to at the start of the program.
Exactly, and let's stay on the defensive side of the ball. And another kid from the greater Austin metropolitan area, Clarence Guidry, a 5'11", 165-pound pounder from Pflugerville, Texas, former Pflugerville Panther, played his high school football for George Herman, also a baseball player, played baseball at Pflugerville High School for Don Fry. Look at his numbers, all district in both football and baseball, played on both sides of the ball, running back and cornerback, rushed for 726 yards and 12 scores out of Coach Herman's offense up there in the greater Austin area. So another cornerback here at Texas State, another talented football player, Brant, and gentleman joining us now. I know he's excited about this big board. I am.
Absolutely. And right now joining us is offensive coordinator Mike Schultz. And right now, yes, the defensive big board is up. We're going to flip things over and take a look at the offense. And you look, and four offensive linemen, a couple of tight ends, two quarterbacks to add some depth, a running back and a receiver. Coach, let's just kind of get your overall assessment of the personnel you've recruited.
Well, you know, needless to say, there was an emphasis on offensive linemen, and we hit that. You know, we've got some big guys. You know, we've got some guys that had some length to them, and we were trying to go in that direction. Dave Schrader is already here. He's already been participating in some of the workouts and stuff. Very excited about him. He's very athletic, can run. Cameron Knight, of course, is not here. Cameron's a big guy, all right? Cameron has a lot of ability, maybe can play a lot of different positions. P.J. Anderson's a very fast receiver. We're excited about him. He actually had been to several of our camps here on campus, and we really think we have a really explosive player there. Stedman Mayberry, again, is a very elusive running back. And then, you know, at quarterback with Randy Price and Connor White, the word is probably the thing we tried to build on is an athletic dual-threat guy. You know, we got two big, good-looking quarterbacks. Both of these guys are on campus. Randy stands about 6'3", maybe even pushing 6'4". Connor is 6'5", and both of them have the ability to run and bring both sides. You know, the hardest thing to evaluate a quarterback on is his ability to make decisions. You know, you can watch him run, you can watch him spin, but the most important thing that a quarterback has to do is make decisions. And, you know, the way you do that is talk to their coaches, go back and talk to even their high school coaches. And, you know, when we were doing this, the things that came back on Connor White and Randy Price were really good. Connor actually worked with a quarterback coach that Coach Fran and I both knew by the name of Jim Donnan. Jim at one time was the head coach at Georgia, the head coach at Marshall, and now since he's retired, he has been working and doing some individual work with quarterbacks in that area and had Connor as one of his students. And, you know, when we got to talking and going back and forth with Jim Donnan, and things really came back very positive on Connor and his ability and his ability to make decisions and do those type of things. His knowledge of the game, you know, he brings a little bit of an edge in there because, you know, Coach Donnan had been able to watch film with him and do some of the things that I liked hearing, and I know Coach Fran liked hearing. And so when we had that conversation and Coach Donnan said some of the things that he did, we were really excited about getting Connor and Randy.
Coach, we know a handful of these players from the state of California. How important has that territory become to what you're doing here at Texas State?
Well, if you notice, there's a theme kind of that we have in California, and it's junior college. I don't know if you know much about the junior colleges in California. First thing, there's probably around 80 of them. And they actually have three different categories. They have a bigger class, a middle class, and a smaller class. But it gives us the ability to go out and maybe get guys that are a little bit more mature, a little bit more physical, a little bit farther along in their career to come in and fit into the program a little bit quicker. And, you know, luckily enough, we've had some success out there in California and Arizona.
Well, Coach, congratulations on what's been a phenomenal signing class so far. We'll announce a few more signees as the broadcast continues, and looking forward to great things out of your offense in 2014.
Thank you.
All right, then again, Mike Schultz, offensive coordinator. More coverage coming up here on TXTBobcats.com. Back at the End Zone Complex for our live coverage of Signing Day 2014. And what would our coverage be without a conversation with the man in charge of it all, head coach Dennis Franchione, entering his fourth season here at Texas State. So fourth recruiting class year, Coach. Things have really changed for you from the first recruiting class to what you have available now. We'll get into all the details of that in just a moment. But first, just your overall assessment of what you've been able to sign today.
You know, all 126 other Division I coaches are excited today. I think part of it's the new class that you have and the new players you welcome to the Bobcat football family and the culmination of a year's worth of work to get to this point or more in some instances today. And knowing that you've got a new infusion of talent coming to your football team. And then for us in this process of going from FCS to FBS, this is another step that's pretty pivotal for us to add talent to our roster to get better in the Sun Belt Conference.
We alluded to the fact that your first year here, you had, six, 7 days to recruit a full class. And the second year, not the full allotment yet with the transition from the FCS to the FBS. And now two full recruiting classes for you, this one being your second of the two. How have things changed over the 4 years to what you've been able to work with now?
There's really not any comparison. The first year, we really did not have much time to recruit, and it was kind of a scramble with us as coaches using our connections that we had to put together what we could in a class. Year two kind of started the stadium project, and it wasn't completed, but you could see the construction going on. We played in Division I, but our identity was really not solidified very well yet. Then the stadium is done. Our program starts to take on a Division I FBS identity, and now finally the Sun Belt Conference, and then of course this year we get to go out and recruit with the second fastest team from making this transition from FCS to FBS to be bowl eligible. So recruiting's never easier, but it's gotten better for us in the standpoint that we have an FBS profile. We're going to be in the same conference for 2 years in a row now. We kind of know who the enemy is a little bit better, know a lot about him. So there's been a lot of changes since I've been here. All good, though.
Coach Fran joins us here, National Signing Day 2014. And Coach, you mentioned, of course, Bobcat Stadium, the expansion. And Brandt alluded to it earlier in the broadcast, how the locker room is going to be a renovation done. The T Association Pavilion is moving right along. You and your coaching staff really have an excellent repertoire, resume to show prospective student athletes, don't you?
We do. Our university is under an explosion, I think, of positive things. I tell recruits and their parents, our school bird's a crane. We've got one on every corner building something. And so there's all kinds of construction. Our academics is going well, and the growth of our university, the vision of our administration. We're still a little bit of a secret to some people maybe in North Texas that haven't been on our campus. You know, they come down here and they're very impressed with the available academics, the facilities that our administration's put in place. The people on this campus are pretty special. They sell this place very well. And, you know, all buildings have bricks and mortar, but people make the difference. And we're fortunate here, whether it's Dr. Gowans giving up every Saturday to visit with our student athletes and parents, or Lori Henson talking academics with them, or whoever it may be. Our people make a big difference. Our players made a big difference in this recruiting class.
Coach, congratulations on this class. And one thing, as I was doing my prep for this morning, is looking at the number of new Bobcats who were multi-sport athletes. You have offensive linemen who play basketball and are track and field stars. You have quarterbacks who played basketball, baseball, and football. Great academics across the board, but I thought it was interesting the number of Bobcats who were signed this morning who can do a number of things athletically.
I think that's a good trademark of this class, and that illustrates athleticism, multi-talented, and a lot of our guys can play more than one position, though we recruited position specific, but guys like Lucas Askew or Gabe Schrade or some of them could certainly play offense or defense. They have in high school, and that's a nice combination to have. We have them targeted at a spot right now, but we know there's flexibility with what we do with them, and that's nice to have in a class.
Coach, something that was brought up with your staff earlier was that the way that recruiting worked after playing a year in the Sun Belt, what did year one of Sun Belt play tell you in regards to the kind of athlete you need to succeed at this level?
I think the biggest thing, when we went out to recruit, I told our coaches, you see what Lafayette looked like, that's what you're looking for. And if you look at our D-line class, this is a pretty exceptional defensive line class. And if you look at their size and things, they're comparable to the people we were playing against. And we have to get bigger and stronger. That's been a target for us since the day I got here. We were a little height deprived when we started, and we're signing a number of guys. I think, I forget what the exact number is, but a number over 6'3". And the defensive line class is really, I think, very special. And if that front four can control the line of scrimmage, which the good teams in the Sun Belt do, then you have a chance to let your linebackers run and make plays and your secondary to cover. And, we've got some guys in that D-line class that can pass rush and that can be good run stoppers with size and strength. And so I think that's one of the biggest items we learned about the Sun Belt Conference. I call it kind of a mini SEC. And, the fact that the Sun Belt was the highest-ranked non-AQ conference was a good statement for us, our success against the other conferences, our 2-0 record in bowl games. All that was positives for us in recruiting.
And all but one team was bowl eligible in the Sun Belt Conference this past season as well. It tells you just how competitive things were. Well, our first guest today was Reuben Vaughn, your recruiting coordinator, and he mentioned the relationship with these players you recruit. For a lot of them start when their sophomores or juniors are coming to your camps, you're getting to know them at a much younger age. That said, how important is retention amongst your coaching staff? We haven't seen much change over the past 3 years for you in regards to recruiting. How important has that been?
It's pretty pivotal in this state in particular. The Texas high school coaches are such great coaches and have great programs. And they develop relationships and trust with your coaches. And so they know and understand that if they send a player to a certain place, they can trust this coach. They know he'll be taken care of. They know what kind of program that you run and what you stand for. And being able to send guys back into the same high school, I think the continuity pays big dividends. And, you know, just stop and think. A guy goes back into the same high school for 3 years, like Craig Nivar, for instance. So he's tracking freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors. And really a large part of January and even some of December is targeting juniors, not finishing up your seniors, but targeting juniors. And we've already had a junior day last weekend where we had about 75 juniors in 2015 classes. So we're starting way ahead on that. And that's the process today. If you look at the top 100 players in this state, probably on August 1st, 75 or 80 of them were committed already. So you've got to go hard and go early. And as I tell our coaches every day, recruiting's like shaving. Do it every day or you look like a bum. And that's what we have to do.
Now, I specifically remember a junior day here 2 years ago. A young kid from Stephenville walked into the end zone complex by the name of Tyler Jones, and he started the majority of your games a year ago. Well, Coach, thank you so much for your time. Congratulations on a great class here in 2014. And you got a busy day ahead. We got to let you go.
Okay, thank you, guys.
All right, we'll wrap things up here on TXABobcast.com after the break.
On behalf of all Texas State student-athletes, I want to say thank you.
Thank you for providing us an opportunity to earn an education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We thank you for your generosity and support.
Welcome back to the End Zone Complex here at Bobcat Stadium on TXABobcast.com. We have your live coverage of signing day 2014. Brant Freeman alongside Bill Culhane. We visited with all the Bobcat coaches, including head coach Dennis Franchione, moments ago. What is an incredible week here of Bobcat athletics. Now, remember, about an hour from now at noon is the Bobcat Club luncheon, which will feature head coach Dennis Franchione to discuss the signing class today. And also, Ricky Woodard and Ty Harrington will be on hand as well. The softball season starts this Friday. Baseball season coming up later this month as well. So those two coaches will talk about their respective programs. And again, that is at 12 o'clock noon at the Embassy Suites just off of I-35. If you haven't already RSVP'd for it, it is $30 at the door. You want to show up. It is a great chance to get to know these coaches a little bit more and about their program. So, you know, Bill, kind of putting a bow on signing day, the athletes, the coaches, just, again, a phenomenal class here in 2014.
It is, and I hearken back to, again, you and I leaving press box there in Troy, Alabama, and you and I, as we're carrying the equipment down to the team bus, you know, we're having a conversation about, okay, what's in store for in 2014, what do the Bobcats need to do on the recruiting trail, and then, of course, the following Monday, we recorded Inside Bobcat Football, the final show for 2013. And we posed the question to Coach Fran, okay, what's going to be the emphasis in recruiting for the 2014 National Signing Day? And, you know, I go back to our conversation, I go back to our visit with Coach Fran on IBF, and I look at this board and home run. You know, you mentioned softball and baseball right around the corner. Well, absolutely hit a home run today. Not the marquee. I don't see any 6 stars, 12 stars, 9-star recruits up there, I joke. But I see a lot of talent there, and I see that the needs were addressed. And as far as the stars go, you know, the Bobcat all-time sack leader, C.J. Carroll, came to Texas State as a walk-on. I mentioned Fred Evans earlier. He came to Texas State as an offensive lineman.
Joplo Bar, too, he was Wellington DeShields' little brother. That's all he was when he got here, and Daryl Morris was a track star. So, you know, stars, schmars, Brant. I think the Bobcats did a great job.
And, you know, something else about this class, particularly on defense, we're going to see a lot of the players we announced today fighting for starting jobs, not just some playing time, starting jobs in 2014.
Well, and I think that's important. As we came up this morning, I ran into Mike Hudson, who, of course, you visited with earlier, defensive line coach, been here for a long time, of course. And that's the word Coach Hudd and I use, with competition, you know, it makes you better. If it doesn't make you better, competition, what it does is it makes you leave the landscape and allow the guys who are willing to compete to continue to get better, to continue to grow, and to win football games. But certainly it's exciting. 2014 season can't get here soon enough. I know there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that'll have to take place before that, starting with spring ball. Coach Fran mentioned it. The end of this month, buddy, we're going to be out there watching the guys throw the ball around, yep, pushing sleds and all that stuff that you and I miss so much.
Yeah, February 28th is the start date for spring football here at Texas State. There will be a week off in between for spring break, but, yeah, the spring football program is going to start here before you know it. One other note about what's going on tonight, Strand Coliseum, the Bobcat women basketball team, they're taking on ULM, coming off a big win. You saw it this past weekend in Bowling Green at Western Kentucky. And the men play ULM tomorrow. The game will be televised as well. 7 o'clock tip from Strand Coliseum this weekend. Both basketball teams in action against the Raging Cajuns. And the men's game on Saturday will feature a very special retirement ceremony for the jersey of Jeff Foster.
Yeah, exactly right. And first of all, Coach Antoine, the women's basketball team, 5-3 in the Sun Belt Conference right now. The Bobcat women have won two games in a row. Western Kentucky, EA Diddle Arena, is a place where opposing teams go to die, so to speak. And the Bobcat women in the second half ran away from the Lady Toppers. The Bobcat men, a hard-fought loss against Western Kentucky in Bowling Green. But ULM, Bobcat women tonight, you mentioned it, Brant, going to look for a little bit of payback against the Warhawks. The Bobcat men held the ULM basketball team, the men's team, to 36 points the first time they met a few weeks ago. And just one final thing, and wanted to mention Jeff Foster, big number 42, is going to hang in the rafters forever. Going to be taking place halftime of the men's game against the Raging Cajuns on Saturday. But keep in mind as well, for those of you who have been following Bobcat basketball for a long time, Dante Mathis is expected to be there, Damian Sansom, a number of guys from those Foster teams, if you will, of the mid to late 90s. So please come out to Strand Coliseum and support Jeff, his teammates, and the Bobcat basketball team. It's going to be a big, important game in the friendly confines.
And again, we're going to take one more break here on TXTBobcast.com and put a wrap on things on our coverage of signing day 2014.
On behalf of all Texas State student athletes, we want to say thank you.
Thank you for providing the opportunity for an education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your generosity and support.
Welcome back to TXTBobcast.com for signing day 2014. It is not just a day for football, other sports here as well at Texas State, soccer and volleyball signees. To find out who those athletes are, just go online to txtbobcast.com, venture on the website a little bit more, and you'll find out all that information. And again, to get all the information on the football signing class, you can also find that out here on the Texas State Athletic website. Some also track and field athletes signing today as well. So track and field, volleyball, soccer, football signees, we have it all for you if you venture further on this website, txtbobcats.com. Well, again, a very exciting day today. Don't forget, coming up at noon, 12 o'clock, it is the Bobcat Club Luncheon with Dennis Franchione, with Ty Harrington, and Ricky Woodard at the Embassy Suites. If you haven't already RSVP'd, it is $30 at the door, and we hope to see you there. For Bill Culhane, all the coaches here from the Texas State football program, I'm Brant Freeman. Thanks for tuning in. You can catch our next edition of Inside Bobcat Athletics right here online at txtbobcats.com in 2 weeks. We'll see you then.